Okay, so this is what we're making today. This is a Stirling motor. So I want you guys to go ahead and open this up. You should be able to go to open, and I think it'll be in the correct directory. Does everybody have SD7 open? What's that? Not yet. Okay.
If you need any help, just raise your hand. We'll be back here to assist you if need be.
Okay, so under SEU14, go ahead and back up to the hands-on. And there should be one called Rendering Realism with KeyShot. Double click that Stirling motor and finally name assembly, which I think is.
Go up to visualization hands-on.
Yeah, you gotta sort it. You might be sorted by park documents from previous sessions. Go ahead and change that to assembly. And you'll see Stirling is the model.
2014.
Does everybody have that?
No.
No, we're still trying to find your files. So what's the path to?
Did you got to back up to the SEU 2014 hands-on?
Yeah.
And then there's a folder called Rendering Realism.
I wonder which folder I'm in.
There it is.
I can see it.
Sterling motor?
C drive, SEU 2014.
Yeah. Go ahead and click that 2014.
All right.
Rendering Realism with KeyShot.
It's Stirling dual.
Yep, and you're sorting by all documents, but there's one called Stirling. It's an assembly. It's an assembly. Yeah. Okay, is anybody not there yet? Okay, good. Okay, so there is a PowerPoint that details this pretty well, which I said you guys will get, but I'm just going to be mostly talking you through it. Okay, so you should have something that looks like. So there's two ways to get this over to KeyShot. You can go to Tools, we have a button over here called KeyShot Render. And the other way is you can go into the ERA environment and there's a similar button that says KeyShot Render. They both do the same thing. So go ahead and click this one that says KeyShot Render. And KeyShot should begin with you. Let me know when everybody's there. Give me some thumbs up. Everybody in KeyShot? Okay. So you might have to full screen it. You might discover the part that's off the screen. So if you do that, you should be able to see both of these panes, one for your library and one for your project.
Bring it in full screen.
All right, you guys mentioned, it doesn't seem like too many people here have any KeyShot experience, so I'll just kind of go over some basics. You can zoom in with the mouse wheel. If you hold the left mouse button and drag, you can rotate around your model up and down. And if you hold the middle mouse button, you can pan. And a button I like to use a lot, especially if you don't have a very high-end computer, is this P button up here. And what this is, this puts you in performance mode. You can see that the quality goes down a little bit, but it's not doing ray tracing anymore, so it makes the model a lot quicker to spin around, and this makes it, in my opinion, a lot easier to drag and drop materials onto it without having to wait for it to update. Because it's constantly live updating. You'll notice though, one of the bad things about that is it turned any kind of translucent surfaces you have into black, so it doesn't calculate those out. Okay. Everybody good? Alright. So on this left hand side you have your library. This has your materials, different colors, your environments, backdrops, everything that you can basically add to this model. The right side, under your project, is where you're going to edit those things that you've added. You can edit your environment, you can edit materials, you have a tree, kind of like Pathfinder and Solid Edge, where you can click on a part and make changes to it that way. But we'll be going through that here shortly. So to go ahead and start off with, under materials, I want you guys to find one for metal, an entry for metal, and expand it on the left-hand side here. And then there's another entry for brass, And underneath that is basic, so go ahead and click that. Everybody good? All right, so we're going to be dragging and dropping this brass rough material on here. So go ahead and just drop it to one of the gold objects. You can pick whatever it is. And this is kind of our workaround. The problem that we're having is when you update, the update's not getting assigned correctly, so some of the faces are changing colors they shouldn't. So our workaround for that is after you apply one material to one of these parts, is I want you guys to hold the shift button on your computer and left click onto that whatever part you just assigned that brass material. After you do that, any of these other brass materials that you see, all the gold colored stuff, you can right click while holding shift and it'll apply it. So that's our workaround. Normally, when you do this, it would just apply it to all the occurrences. So if you know this wheel, for example, is two, it's an occurrence. They're both the same part. So applying the material to one should apply the material to other, to the other one. As I said, we're having to do a little workaround today. So go ahead and find all the gold parts.
You said hold the shift key?
Yeah, while you're holding shift, you just click the right key, the right mouse button. And there's not too many of them. You guys will notice there's one inside this glass here. So to get through, you can't really drag and drop materials or assign materials through objects in KeyShot. So over here in your project, you want to make sure you're in scene, in the scene tab, and click on the glass here. You'll see it highlighted here, and there's a checkbox. You need to uncheck that, and it makes that glass go away. So now we can hold shift and right click and assign our brass material.
Shift left click to pick up target. And
shift left is basically right copy, and shift right is paste. Yeah. Okay, so I'm going to do the same thing over here. Just turn off this glass piece. Hold my shift button, the right mouse button click for that one too. Turn it back on. Anybody still working on that, assigning materials?
What happens if you mess up and change something that you're not supposed to in the material that it's not supposed to be?
Well, you can hit edit undo, or you can just drag the material back onto it, or drop the material back onto it. Okay.
If you need any assistance, raise your hand.
No, just left click it and see if I want to click and release. There you go. Now, go over there and shift and right click on that one.
Yeah, just a second for everybody to get caught up. Steve, you guys good?
We've got to catch up with you, going.
Okay. All right, so our next material, still underneath metal where you guys were. You can collapse brass, it might make it a little bit easier to maneuver.
I've never used this
one. I want you guys to select stainless steel.
I was just wondering if I could do something.
And the second one from the bottom, let me also mention this. My screen, you notice, this kind of has a list view. Yours might look like this. You know, these previews don't do a whole lot for me, so I like to put it in list view and actually see what they're called. So you can click this button down here if you guys want to have the same view. But completely up to you. But we're going to pick this second from the bottom one, stainless steel linear brush and noise. All right, so go ahead and select that. We're going to do the same thing. We're just going to drag and drop it onto any of these parts that came over as aluminum from solid edge, any of these gray parts, let go. Then we're going to do the same hold shift, left mouse click, and now you've copied it and you can start pasting it to all these other parts. So the only one that's kind of a pain in the butt is there's a whole bunch of these screws here. I think there's 12 in total. So go ahead and apply those individually. Again, if this the face assignment stuff is working correctly, that wouldn't be the case. You would just be able to drag and drop it onto one of these and you'd be fine.
If you had all bolts over in the file manager, could you not select all the ones from there?
Yeah, you could select them all that way and drag and drop it. You should be able to.
Thank you.
Yeah, Make sure you get these guys in the back here. They're easy to miss.
So if you shift left key, left click, shift left button on the mouse button, copy, and then you shift right click and you drop that. You copy that, so now you shift right click, shift right click. Yeah, and that apply that. Well, probably because it was so similar in code, it's going to get it may have already been that clear to start with that.
Alright, how's everybody doing, you guys? We're still having applications going on right now. Okay. Does anybody need any help?
Where's the
file? He just got in here, so. Here, I'll catch him up.
Okay. It's under Siemens and SEU14.
So you drag the brad. Looks like you got your flywheel set where you want it. That's right. Okay. So now if you shift and left mouse click on that same flywheel that you've already applied to. Yeah. Right. Didn't light up.
You guys, let me know when you're. Is there anybody still working on that? You're helping.
Yeah. Hold on.
Okay.
Shift left mouse button doesn't seem to be picking up a target for us. Can you take a look at it?
Sure. Yeah, it's really touchy on selecting parts. You don't want to see that.
So what was the issue? We had to be on the
If anybody else is having problems with that, you need to be in your project pane in the scene tab. That's you really can't select any parts graphically in KeyShot unless you're in that scene tab. Okay, everybody good? We still got a few catching up, but we'll go ahead and get on. Okay, so you should have something that looks kind of similar to this one. All right, next we're going to add a material to that kerosene wick. So back to the key shot, we're talking about...
What was the brass that you used?
Brass rough. It's under basic. Okay, so we're talking about these wicks right here. So, I need you guys to go under materials. We're going to go to cloth and leather and expand that. There's an entry for nylon. Pick that. There's nylon fabric white. So, I'm going to pick that one, drag and drop it here. And I'm going to do the same thing for the other one. I'm just going to hold shift left click and shift right click over this side. Actually, I'm sorry, you don't have to do it on that one because it was an occurrence and it already copied it over. So just drag and drop it under one of those weights and it will apply it to both of them. Okay, so now, everybody got that?
What material are you using there?
Pardon me?
The cloth and leather is what?
Which material?
Nylon.
Yeah. Okay. So I want you guys to right mouse button click, and we're going to click on the wick, and we're going to click edit material. You'll see that your pane over here changed. So now you're in the material tab. This lets you control colors, roughness you see here. There's some transmission things you can change, refraction, index. That just controls kind of like what sort of light's getting through. Usually that's just on glass. I want you guys to go ahead, once you're there, click on the textures tab within the material.
Just change it. It was fuzzy when I was doing something.
Yeah, it's really great. So your paint should now look like this. All right, once you guys are there, we're going to change this right, drop down right here that says box map. We're going to change it to UV coordinates. Just to kind of explain what that's doing, box map just looks at an object as if it's planar. And obviously this is a round object, it's not planar. So UV coordinates kind of works just like spherical, or cylindrical would in this case too, would work just as well. But it just is aware of what kind of shape the geometry takes and it tries to match it better. So we're going to go ahead, change that to UV coordinates in that drop down. And now in the scale box, I want you guys to key in 0.75. Now notice on some of these machines, the resolution's a little bit lower. You might have to drag your paint over to be able to see the box to key in. So you can key that in and hit enter. You can see it's not much of a change. So all that did was change the scale of our texture on this wick here, these little boxes. Now they're a little bit difficult to see. Maybe you want them to show up more. So we have another control here for bump height. So I'm going to go ahead and key in 5 for that. And that's going to make it stand up more. It just makes your texture, basically the height that it's kind of rendering it at, is a little bit taller, so it makes it more visible. And that's all we're doing with the width. So everybody got that? Okay. Anybody else need more time?
What color did you use for the wick chrome?
Oh, it's you go. It's under stainless steel.
Okay.
And it's the second one from the bottom. It's linear noise. Okay. We're going to go back over to our materials on the left hand side. We're going to pick wood. Scroll down, you'll see there's an entry for oak. Go ahead and drag and drop that onto our base right here. Okay, you should, from the last step, still be in this material tab. If not, go ahead and click it. We're going to click on this blend with color box right here. That's going to open up this palette. So I want to go ahead and make this oak a little bit darker, but I'll just tell you guys because it's pretty cool. You can open up a picture from the Internet Explorer, from wherever, of a piece of wood, something like that, and click this dropper and go anywhere in Windows. It doesn't have to be in KeyShot. And whatever material that you fall under or whatever color you land on, it's going to go ahead and apply it. So if you had a picture of a wood that had some real fine grain that happened to be kind of a dark color like you liked, you could pick that. And it would end up looking more realistic. But for us, just because I want to make it a little darker, I'm just going to go ahead and click somewhere down here. You can see instantly that made our piece of wood a little bit darker. Once I do that, I'm going to hit OK.
Yes, sir. Yeah, that's hard to tell. Just,
and all this stuff, too, we're going to leave the settings alone, but this has a texture entry as well where you can make the bump taller, you can change the scale, you can change the angle at which the wood grain is going at. So any texture that's in here, you have a lot of options to control. All right, I'm going to go ahead and turn performance mode off so I can see my glass. That's at the top of the screen up here. So that's what we're going to do next. We're going to go on the materials tab back over here, the glass. There's a drop down next to it. Go ahead and go to clear. And there's an entry for glass basic white. So we have two glass objects here. We have this one and this one, two separate parts, I should say. So go ahead and drag it on this first one here. And do your shift left click and copy it. And then you need to apply shift right click these two down here. KeyShot does have a number of kind of translucent liquid materials. I think I'm just going to leave this one the way it is because it suits our purpose. Kind of looks like kerosene. It works fine. But I think like Thomas showed you guys during the presentation, they have beer, they have a couple of different things that I'm kind of fun to play with. One other thing while we're just waiting on a few people to catch up. As you mentioned, this KeyShot cloud back here. I'm not sure. No, I'm not connected to the internet right now. But if you click that, it's going to open a little dialog, and you're going to be able to use textures, materials, environments from other KeyShot users that they've chosen to upload kind of onto a cloud server. Kind of think of it as GrabCAD, where you can kind of pick and use other designers' materials and their parts and stuff like that. And that's really cool. You can bring that into your model. Maybe somebody has a really realistic wood texture or wood material. Yes.
Along the edge of the base where the grain's oriented wrongly, is it easy to flip that?
So you can try and change, so you're just asking about down here, you see the grain doesn't quite follow correctly. You can play with the different mapping, so if I just want to do that real quick, I can go to edit material after I'm in my scene tab, I go to textures. I can try and change the map here, maybe try UV coordinates. But it looks like it has the same problem. So in that case, what you'd have to do if you wanted to change that is you'd have to go back to solid edge. You would need to make that face a different color. It can be any color, it could be purple, whatever. You would just go to underneath.
As long as it's different to the rest of the base so that you can apply
correct
a texture to that one face.
Right, because that's how KeyShot works, is you're dragging and dropping on the colors. So, you know, this is one solid color, so it means it's all the same material. But if I had this as purple, red, it doesn't matter. That's another surface, another style that I can drop a different material onto.
That actually looks better now just with that change.
Yeah. So all I did that time is I changed the plane to Z, so it's trying to run everything along that back plane.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we've got our glass material applied. Let me go ahead and try and add some light to these candles here. So first thing I'm going to do is add another glass basic white to these flames right here. You saw just clicking on one, applied it to both. So after I do that, I'm going to right click, go to edit material. And if you can't right click, it could be because you're not in the scene tab. You needed to be in the scene tab to start when you do that. Okay. So I've got my glass material applied, I've gone to the edit materials, I'm going to click color again. I'm going to try and look, find something kind of orange, red, something that looks like a flame.
Looks like you're on the material tab though, or should you be in the material tab?
Yeah. Okay, after you got that, just okay. There's a checkbox down here for two-sided. So what that does is if you have a glass surface or something that you want to be glass, but maybe it's a solid object, maybe you didn't shell out the inside of it, or you didn't do a revolve and have an inside blank kind of area, you can click this two-sided button and it'll basically do that for you. All right, so once I do that, I'm gonna go back to the scene tab up here. I'm going to click on this guy, on the left plane, and I'm going to turn him off. Now, I'm going to select this kind of inner part of the plane. What we're going to do is we're going to, on the material side, scroll down to light here. And I'm going to go to point light. So what this is going to do is add a lighted material. And the reason I had you guys select this is KeyShot's a little funky about adding light material. Sometimes if you just try and drag and drop it, it doesn't get assigned to the right material or it doesn't assign at all. So kind of a pro tip, I'll just say it works much better if you go ahead and select what you're trying to drag and drop onto first, and then drag and drop it, not onto the part, but onto the part that's highlighted in the scene tree over here. You can see it lit apart. So from there I can go to I can go from this tree, right click, and there's a little expanded area for material. I can click edit material to get back over here. And we can go ahead and turn that down to about 10 watts. you don't need it quite that bright. Everybody got that done? Is anybody that needs more time? Okay. So with this still highlighted over here, click back in the scene and make sure it's still highlighted, and go ahead and do your shift left click to copy that material. And you can see the checkbox right above it is going to turn that glass back on, so let's go ahead and do that. You should have the outer part of the flame come back. All right, we're just going to do the same thing to the other flame now. So we're going to have a light in the scene. You have to be in the scene tab. Go ahead and click. Once it's highlighted over here, click your checkbox and turn it off. And we should be able to just shift right click. For some reason, it didn't pick that up. So I guess we might need to go ahead and run the light material one more time. So on the inner part of the flame, go ahead and select it one more time so it's highlighted over here in the scene. And yet again, drag and drop the point light 100 watt white onto it. And we're just going to do the same thing, right mouse button click. On that pop-up, go to material, then edit material. Go ahead and key in 10 watts to take power.
Drag that light onto that, not onto the graphics.
Oh, okay.
There's a problem. He said it better works well if you drop it on for the item of the
tree. All right. Go back to scene and turn that back on. And you should have something that looks like this.
Beautiful.
All right, we're looking pretty good on time right now, so let's go ahead and do a quick render. So to do that, I'm going to click down here, go to render. So this is a basic rendering dialog, and this is going to be your output resolution. As Thomas mentioned, it's really nice. We can make that basically anything we want for huge prints, but obviously the larger the resolution, the much longer it takes to render it out. So maybe pick something kind of small, somewhere in between. Maybe it's 1024 by 1019 on my monitor. I'm not sure if you guys have the same resolution as I do. It might be a little bit different. Kind of pick something like that. And you can also control the DPI, but we'll just leave it at the default. That's 300. So make a note of where this is. This is where your rendered file is going to end up. And you can change that to anything you want. But we're going to... Also, I'll show you guys these options. Under quality here, you can control how many ray bounces each ray light is making, how many samples are taking, this pixel blur kind of sharpens things up a little bit. You can change the anti-aliasing, increase the shadow quality, and you can add the sharper texture filtering, which doesn't have too much of a detrimental effect on the rendering, actually, so you might want to go ahead and click that one. So for now, we're just going to go ahead and accept all these the way they are, except maybe for the sharper texture filtering. But you can control and make much cleaner looking pictures with all these controls. So obviously, when you do that, it's going to increase the rendering time exponentially, depending on what your settings are. So you can go ahead and back up to output, make sure everything looks good, and click render. And this box is going to show up. Notice in your screen, I'm sure, but you'll see in the middle, it's starting to render it out. So you'll see it says 1%, you're like, man, that's really slow, there's a lot left, but it's only rendering, taking time to render what your object is. So all of the environment, all this gray stuff right here, it doesn't have to render it, so it's going to zip right by it. So it's a little misleading, it's not going to take quite that long. So is everybody at this step right now? They're doing a render right now? Talk amongst yourselves, wait to see how pretty it looks.
So, a dumb question here. I assume there's no relationship between any materials that you assign in solid edge and what you see in here when you start the process?
No, there isn't. Now, you should be able to, I haven't tried it out because the material template thing's pretty new, but based on what I got from talking to Thomas, you should be able to say whatever material is coming through that material template, like aluminum, you should be able to apply their aluminum. The thing there is, I don't think our aluminum always comes over as just aluminum. I think it comes over as like aluminum 1, 2, 3. Am I right about that, Nathan?
I think there's some, I don't know all of it, I think there's some capability to create rules for
mapping.
Almost like, you know, it has the text aluminum.
Right, if it said that.
And similar for part names, you can do stuff like, it has the name screw, use stainless steel.
Right.
There's things, some capability for that. Hmm.
If you added a G bag or something in solid edge on a certain face, will it also render then?
Yeah, you'd have to update your model. We'll go over that as soon as this is done, actually.
Okay.
So, you know, actually, I'm not going to render mine out. You guys keep doing yours, and I'll keep going. So to kind of touch on the question that was just asked, if I go back to solid edge, I can make any changes to my model. I can, you know, edit a part, make something a different color, add geometry, whatever I want to do. And the change I'm going to make, to bring that over to my KeyShot model, I have to click this button up here, which is KeyShot Update. That's going to go back over to KeyShot, and nothing changed on my model because we didn't do anything. Actually, that's not true. This is kind of a problem I was talking about, that we're having to do this differently. If you guys notice, it changed my glass stuff to brass. So that's the bug we're working out right now. So I'm going to go ahead and just make these glass again. Okay, so it's on all the various parts. So I can select these though, right click and do an unlink material somewhere. And now I should be able to drag and drop my glass back. Bear with me for 1 second, guys. I'm sorry. Okay, so mine's back where it should be. So normally, though, that's not going to happen. It's just kind of, it's a beta build, so it's an issue that just kind of cropped up once we got here. Again, sorry we couldn't do anything about it. I also see it changed the wick color as well. I'm not going to mess with that right now. But that's what you do. You go to Solid Edge, make whatever changes you want. You're going to click KeyShot Update. Now, Thomas also mentioned, if I want to go ahead and save this, you can get back into it. So you guys can save these if you want. I'm just going to save it. So I'm going to save it to my desktop so I know where it's at here. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and close KeyShot. Now I could close Solid Edge, I could come back a day, 2 weeks, a month, a year later, it doesn't matter. Go back into KeyShot. I'm going to open my same model. Okay, now as soon as I close KeyShot, our KeyShot update grayed out. We can't do it anymore. But if I have the same model open in Solid Edge, and like I said, time's not a factor, you can come back, open it up. If I hit render, you're going to get this message that says that Solid Edge detects a matching file being rendered in KeyShot. Would you like to use this file instead? So if I click yes, it reestablishes our live link connection and lets us be able to drag and drop stuff. And I'm still kind of getting some weird material stuff, but just ignore that for the moment, sorry. But okay, I want everybody now, everybody's got their renders, they come out, okay. I'm gonna go back to Solid Edge, and underneath Tools, I'm gonna go to ERA. I'm gonna click the Animation Editor. Okay, and there is animation for this motor moving. You can go ahead and hit play and preview it. Okay. One other thing to mention with KeyShot, I told you guys about the performance button. KeyShot is constantly trying to trace and render this stuff and trace all the rays. So if you actually went to your CPU right now, it's running at 100% while it's trying to do all this. It's CPU based, so you can have even an onboard graphics card and be able to use KeyShot pretty well if you have a different, decent CPU. So if you're trying to multitask, do some other stuff, there's a pause button right here. You can click that, and that's going to take the load off of our CPU. So you notice when I went to Solid Edge and tried to play this, it was pretty choppy. So now it works a lot better. Okay, so that's our animation. Go ahead and stop it. I can click up here, you notice in ERA, there's a separate KeyShot render and update, like I mentioned earlier. I'm going to go ahead and click update. You're going to get this dialog that's trying to build this animation and send it over to KeyShot. Give that just a minute. I've seen it get stuck online before. Did that work for everybody? Yeah? Okay. One second. I'm going to close out KeyShot. I've had this problem one other time. Of course, when you're doing a demonstration, it's going to do it that time again. Everybody back in KeyShot, it's loaded up your animation. So to see our animation, down here next to that render button we used a minute ago, go ahead and click on animation. And this pane should look very familiar. The one in Solid Edge. So we sent our animation over, and that works for explodes as well as animation. Basically anything you do with the array. And a really cool one is you can do a material change from Solid Edge. So if you have an object that you want to start off as a solid, and then while you're moving the animation, have it become translucent, maybe there's something like this piston moving inside of it, and you want to show that off, you can set that up in the animation, have it, you know, change to translucent for 5 seconds, then back, and send that over to KeyShot, and it looks pretty good. So before I go any farther with this, I'm going to go ahead and kind of get this lined up the way I like it. And up here at the top, you'll see there's a slider and a box for perspective. I'm going to go ahead and key in 70. And that changes the perspective of our model. And I'm also going to go over here to environments from our library. And there's a whole bunch of different ones. They're separated by interior, outdoor, and studio. And I'm going to go to studio. I think it's under basic here. There's one called Shadow Pass. There we go. All you got to do to bring these into your model or into your scene is just drag and drop it. And that changes the lighting. And of course, if you have outdoor environments, anything like that, you can just drag and drop the same way. As I mentioned before, that's what's going to be really nice about KeyShot Cloud is, you know, KeyShot comes with some really decent high resolution basic backdrops, including some really nice outdoor and kind of interior ones. But you know, you kind of use those up pretty quick depending on what you're modeling. So once you have the KeyShot Cloud, if users are updating or uploading their own environments, that'll be pretty nice because there's not too many decent free ones online. What you're looking for are HDR files, and you can find some and just load them up into your KeyShot file folder, and they'll show up here under environments. But said, it'll be nice when you have a bunch of those to play with. It'll be right here in KeyShot Cloud. Okay, so once we've done that, and again, let me kind of make this the way I want it. I can go over to camera, my project tree. See, there's this twist right here. I'm going to go ahead and zero that out. That's going to set it up so that the base plane is aligned how I want it. You can also mess with these sliders, spin things around that way. If you try and do it with the mouse, it'll probably mess up your base plane and give you a twist again. Inclination is just how you're looking at it vertically. And distance is your camera distance. So get that somewhere that you kind of like, somewhere kind of a three-quarter view, something like this. I want you guys to click on this plus sign over here and say add camera. And before you did that, you did set camera 2, so that's what it's going to call that camera. You can name it whatever you want though. So everybody got that? All right, so we're going to go back down to our animation here. Click animation wizard. Get this nice window that pops up. We're going to click orbit. Click next. We're going to select camera 2. That's the one that we just added, so it's going to start at this view. We're going to click next again. You can expand these settings. So basically what we did, we just added a 360 degree orbit from the basic view that we're at right now around our object. And you can set how long you want that orbit to take, just like you can in Solid Edge. So I'm going to go ahead and change this to 7. I'm going to click finish. And you can get your preview. And it's just going to keep looping. Okay, so at this point you can go to render. There's a button here at the top that says animation. This gives you a whole other set of controls that's pretty similar to the still image. You can select your resolution, your video, and I'll make a point of this, you have to select whether you want frame output or video output. So for most of us, we're going to do video output. Frame output would be if somebody's trying to construct the video in some sort of video editor, frame by frame on their own. You can name it whatever you want, make sure it's saving where you want. Notice the total duration there. You would click render. If you do that now, it's going to take about 2 hours. So don't do it. But I do have one that I did. It's for this. And ended up looking like that. So I'm not sure off the top of my head how many frames that is, but if it's set to 30 frames per second, you do it for, it's an 8 second long clip, you're gonna end up having to render all those frames. That's why it takes so long. I know the motor demonstration, the motor explosion that you guys saw in the presentation yesterday, Dan Vincent did that. He's one of our planners, and I think he said it took him all weekend to render that. So it's definitely cool when it's done, but it takes a little while. So
they said something. I was talking to them about you can. I think with this one, you can share other computers on the network to process.
You can. I don't know if you guys have gone by their booth, but their setup's pretty ridiculous. They have a tower with 32 CPUs. And they have another machine on top of that one that's networked in with an additional 32 CPUs. So they don't have to hit that performance mode button. Their stuff renders very quickly. But for the rest of us, I don't know, I didn't make a point of this, but you can control, I have an i7 on this computer, so it has 4 cores plus hyperthreading, so it sees it as 8. You can set how many cores you're using at a time to render, as well as the live render here. You can choose it from this drop-down. But yeah, you can network in other computers, and you can use their CPUs to help boost your rendering time. And I've never done it, but I've read about it online, and it seems like it worked pretty well.
Justin, I think that's a KeyShot Pro.
What's that?
I think that's a Pro feature.
Oh, we're not going to have that?
I don't think so.
Okay. Well, maybe we better ask Thomas, and I'm not sure. Yes.
Just looking at that animation you were showing a few seconds ago, I know that one of my customers would say, why aren't the candles flickering? Can you imagine any way of doing that? I'm not to dwell on it, but would that be feasible to do?
Yeah, the only way you could do it, you'd have to find that one specific object, the inner part of the flame that we shine the light to, mm-hmm. and that when I talked about before, you can make an object translucent and non-translucent again. You'd have to do that. You'd have to do it probably about 10 times or something like that and have it a real short duration on and off again really quickly.
Yeah.
But you could do it. Yeah. And actually, that's everything I have for the presentation, guys. And, you guys go ahead. Thank you.